Thank you for coming. Thank you for realizing that libertarians probably spend way too long winning arguments against others and against each other, and not enough time winning supporters. These are two very, very different things, as I propose to show to you in the next hour or two. What I'm going to give you here is kind of a one and a half hour intro to basically a day of training material that I deliver. And I'm going to start with something that's going to sound a little academic. It's going to sound a little far removed at the beginning from politics. But as my talk goes on, we're going to get closer and closer to the point we have. And the point we have is, how do we start winning supporters for liberty? And we're going to find out that that is not the same thing as winning arguments. It's very, very different. We're going to do a little bit of psychology. We might even do a little bit of neurology. And then eventually we're going to talk about politics, and we're going to talk about sales and marketing of ideas. Because if you actually want to start winning elections, or if you're an activist for liberty, that's the business you're in. You're in trying to become weapons of mass persuasion, which is what I want to make everybody who comes to listen to my my talks. Now, let's see. My bona fides, the reason I'm here is that back in 2011, I was given an opportunity to write on the Huffington Post, that well-known progressive online rag. And I was one of those people who was completely uninterested in politics for nearly all of my life. That only changed in about 2010. And so I was given this opportunity to write on Huffington Post in 2011. And I was one of those people who could have said, oh, but most of my best friends are progressives, right? I was at university studying physics. I studied physics and philosophy of science. I have no background in politics and economics at all. I am now a commentator in politics and economics. It helps not to be educated, because then you're not indoctrinated. So you can actually see things a little bit as they are. You know, that's what I think. Anyway, I'm biased, of course. So I got this gig to write on the Huffington Post, and I had no interest in actually being a writer, because I don't like narcissists. And there's, you know, 7 billion people in the world, 1 billion of them fancy themselves as writers on the internet. Didn't need another one. But I had this opportunity, Huffington Post, big platform, to the left, and I basically was a liberal by default. So if you ask me about my politics, they used to be when I was uninterested in politics, I was a liberal by default. By which I mean, hadn't really read any books about it, but was a nice guy, kind of educated, preferred justice to injustice, less poverty to more poverty, that kind of thing. Notice there's this thing called law, this thing called government. Obviously, a better policy is one that kind of manifests or mandates those good intentions, right? Politics are left, politics are good intentions. We'll talk a bit more about that. So that's what I would say now. I was a liberal by default. And all my friends were too. So I thought I'll use this platform on Huffington Post just to see if I can pull some lefties over for my favorite candidate at that time, who was Ron Paul. And so I wrote this article called If You Love Peace, Become a Blue Republican, just for a year. Blue Republican because Ron Paul was running Republican. Blue because I was trying to pull over Democrats. There's a bit more to it than that, but anyway. The article went viral, and then all of a sudden, I'm doing 60 or 70 media interviews about Blue Republican, what is this movement, blah, 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 and it grew. And we ended up being, from week one, the largest, numerically largest, single coalition for Ron Paul's presidency in 2011-2012, right up until the convention. All from one article that went viral on the Huffington Post. That article kind of used some of the techniques we're going to be talking about. But that was kind of the beginning of my career in politics and political persuasion, which is what we're going to be doing here. So with that self-intro, let's get going. Now, I said that I was studying physics. My roommate at Cambridge in England, where I was studying physics, was a social and political science major. And interestingly, the social and political science majors at Cambridge were made to read this book, The Structure of Scientific Revolutions, Who's ready? Okay. If you're serious about politics, read this book that has nothing to do about politics. Okay? Because when you're doing politics in the sense of trying to persuade people of things, you are dealing with human knowledge, and this book written in 1962 by a guy called Thomas Kuhn, K-U-H-N, you can write that down, is all about human knowledge and how it is created and how it changes.
What's the title?
The Structure of Scientific Revolutions. The guy was a historian of science, most important one of modern times, because of this book that he wrote, which was seminal in the philosophy of science, right? Philosophy of science included epistemology, how we know what we know. The reason this book is important if you're interested in politics and psychology and selling political ideas. I'm using selling in quotes, right? I'm not asking money to to explain libertarianism to people, although that might not be a good idea given the party's funds. Paradigms. This is the book that talks all about paradigms. Coined the term paradigm, really. We hear it all the time now, but 1962, Thomas Kuhn, the word paradigm, mainstreamed the word, certainly academically. So what is a paradigm? It's a set of concepts. It's a set of concepts and the relationships between those concepts. Concepts that you use subconsciously or unconsciously to see and interpret the world. But the important point is, you use your concepts to even see the world. We know we use concepts to interpret the world, but did anybody catch my quote on the front? Goethe, we see only what we know. We see only what we know, not we know only what we see, which is completely counterintuitive. Goethe's like the German Shakespeare, right? Very smart guy. We see only what we know. And that quote is what Kuhn went into some detail about in this book. If we don't already know something, then we can't even perceive it. It's an almost ridiculous claim on its face, but it's deeply true. Okay, now there are all kinds of paradigms. Our paradigms are articulated usually in our vocabulary. Each paradigm has an associated vocabulary. And in different paradigms, the same words can actually have different meanings because they have different connotations and different relationships to other meanings. Right? Now, if that all sounds a bit abstract, just bear with me. We're going to start a long way from politics and move towards politics. Now, the classic example of this that Kuhn talked about in his Structure of Scientific Revolutions, he's talking about advances in scientific knowledge, which we're going to apply to political knowledge. The classic example is from physics. And he talks about mass and time in physics. Now, in Newton's world, Isaac Newton's world, everything has a certain mass, right? Do you remember this from high school? F equals ma and all that, right? It doesn't matter what you do with the thing, it's got an amount of stuff in it, and it's 3 kilos, and that's it. Right? It doesn't matter if you move it, or you throw it, whatever, it's 3 kilos. In Newton's world also, time is this thing that ticks by, kind of at the rate of a second, right? What other rate can it go at? Yeah? So it doesn't matter what you do, it doesn't actually affect time. Right? Didn't know you were going to come and get a physics lesson, did you? That was Newton, 17th century. Einstein in the 20th century comes along with general relativity. It's a new scientific paradigm, right? Also has mass in it, E equals mc squared, everyone's heard of that, right? The thing about E equals mc squared is, when things start moving, i.e. they have more energy, they have more E, their mass starts changing, right? And in general relativity, if you put a big heavy planet in the middle of space, space-time warps around it, and time doesn't tick at the rate of a second anymore. Time changes. Okay, why am I going into this? Same words, completely different meanings. To understand those completely different meanings, you actually have to use the concepts in relation to other concepts. What also is important about that is, there is no way you can explain Einsteinian physics to a Newtonian. You've got a big problem, because you're using the same words with completely different meanings. Okay? I hope you are already jumping ahead of me and starting to see why this is relevant to our job of selling liberty to the masses. Right? Now, moving it a little more closer to home. Literally. We have linguistic and cultural paradigms as well as scientific ones. Right? Home. The word home in English has no direct translation to any language. It's kind of an interesting one. Your home might be your house, you might be brought where you live for 20 years. That could be one. But you could also go on a trip, let's say to Orlando, Florida, to have a hotel room. You know, and you're out to take an afternoon out at Disney World, and you say to your spouse, "No, I'm just going home," referring to the hotel room. You can use the word home in that way in English. Can't do that in any other language. We have a cultural idiom in English, whereby lay my hat is home. Same word, different meaning. How do you explain that to a Frenchman? With great difficulty. Okay? No direct translation, not even close. Now, you can explain it to a Frenchman if you also can speak French. Well, right, in other words, you can think and operate in the French language paradigm, but you still can't do a direct translation. You have to kind of use what you know of French to start kind of pointing in the direction of this concept home. Right? Starting to relate this to pointless conversations you've had on Facebook. Right. Now here's one of my favorites. Now, I told you we'd be moving towards politics. I studied Chinese when I lived in Taiwan for a while, studied Chinese. And the word for should in Chinese is ingai, which you say hi like that. Ingai. So you can translate should to ingai and ingai to should for years. You're gonna do just fine. So you could say, I should get up 8 tomorrow to go to my class. Should mean that, right? Now, what does should mean in English? If you actually like deconstruct, if that's the right word, the meaning should, what you're really saying is, there exists some set of behavioral or moral norms and standards according to which the behavior I'm about to specify is preferred. That's kind of what the word should means, right? You can translate that meaning into ingai. It's actually kind of sits in a Judeo-Christian kind of conception of right and wrong when we use should in English. Now, the Chinese ingai, or ingai, it works, but after you've been reading or speaking Chinese for a couple of years, you realize that you've been saying something kind of a fundamentally different connotation. The Chinese culture is Confucian. It's not Judeo-Christian. So when the Chinese say they should do something, what they are meaning is doing the following behavior will increase harmony. Doesn't presuppose any moral system, really. So now think about it. When the Americans come back from the United Nations and they've won some great human rights concession from the Chinese, and the Americans say, oh, yes, we got the Chinese to do XYZ, finally the Chinese know what they should do. They're doing what they should do on human rights, right? From our paradigm, right, they've started to behave in a way that's more consistent with human rights, let's say, right? They have done what they should do. Now, in their paradigm, using their same word or their nearest equivalent, they've also done what they should do. But for them, what they have just done is increased harmony with the Americans or with the West or whoever's trying to get them to make this, what to us is a moral concession. Are you with me? Right? So what the Chinese have just done is brought some strategic advantage. That's what they meant. They brought some harmony. They're going to use this harmony later. Right? They've got a very long time horizon in Chinese. So here we are. Different paradigms. Right? And you see how manifest, how subconscious, and how pervasive they are. We're using them even when we don't know we're using them. Herein, ladies and gentlemen, lies the problem with selling libertarianism to liberals and conservatives and anyone else who's not, who are, let's say, stuck in their paradigm and maybe have never even really been able to think in arts. But we'll get to it. Now, I'm making some big claims. Let's talk about a specific experiment where these were tested, where we see only what we know, as Goethe said, was actually tested. There was an experiment done in Harvard University in, I believe, 1949 called the Perceptions of Incongruity Experiment. This guy can give him a talk, he's not even upset. If I get anything wrong, just raise your hand again. very important for you to know this, because it's almost unbelievable. It's a very simple experiment. There were multiple subjects, participants, and they were shown playing cards at high speed, and all they had to do was call out the playing cards. They were six, seven of hearts, three of diamonds, jack of spades, whatever. At some time, oh, and they were also, I should say, hooked up to monitoring equipment to measure their physical stress responses, right? So we're going to measure heartbeat, we're going to measure sweat on the skin by measuring electric current on the skin and things like that. Now, at some point in the midst of this experiment, the cards, the red and the black cards are, the color has changed, right? So there'll be a seven of hearts, but it would be black. Or three of spades, and it would be red. Okay, they just switched the red and the black on the occasional card. Now, what did the participants call out? What would they actually see? If you show someone a red seven of spades, they don't see a red seven of spades. If they are operating in the playing card paradigm, they know they're looking at playing cards, right? So they see a playing card. They just say seven of spades. In other words, they see a black seven of spades. Or maybe they, because they see the red, and they say seven of hearts or seven of diamonds, but they're still seeing something that they already know exists. They cannot see the thing they're actually seeing, which is a seven of spades made red. Goethe is actually right. You do see only what you know, and we've tested it in laboratories. Okay. Now, what is the monitoring equipment saying? What's happening to these subjects in this experiment is they're getting more and more stressed subconsciously. They don't know they're getting stressed, but their body is getting stressed. Right? So the heart rate's increasing, the sweat on the skin is increasing. In other words, they are physically disposed to not allow for their paradigm not to change. Okay? Now here's the really important thing I want you to take away from this experiment. When they see a red seven of spades, when they are being shown a red seven of spades, but they actually see a seven of hearts, a seven of diamonds, or a black seven of spades, the thing that they're seeing that doesn't exist reinforces their prevailing paradigm, right? They are now seeing data that reinforces the fact that they're looking at real playing cards, even though they're not seeing that data at all. This is what we have to get through in the art of political persuasion. Right? And libertarians know this more than anybody. Because libertarians like to do this thing where they go, if I give them some facts, then I make this tight logical argument, and then I basically answer all their questions factually. Right? Then obviously they'll get it eventually, right? As if people work that way. If you've got any arguments on Facebook like that, better man than I am if you have. Because we don't work that way. Right? We don't work that way. We're really going to get into finding out why not and what to do about it as we go through this talk. In the experiment, the cards were then shown at a decreasing rate, more slowly, and the discomfort levels, as registered by the equipment, rise, until eventually, of course, you have what Kuhn talks about in this book, a paradigm shift. Eventually, you get this, something's wrong here, something's wrong, something doesn't fit, right? When I'm overexposed to, as it were, to non-fitting data. I go, oh my god, hold on, that is a red seven of spades. What the hell is going on here? Now I know I'm not in the playing card pattern. The stress goes, and from this point I see the truth at every next card. Okay? So what we're in the business of doing, if we're trying to make a country full of libertarians, is cause a mass paradigm shift. This is the intro to the one-day seminar on how to do that. Right. See me afterwards if you're interested in the whole day. So let's actually bring it now to politics. I'm going to use a few somewhat distant political examples first, because they're kind of often easier to accept. In 2006, 45% of Republicans stated there were WMDs in Iraq, according to polls. 28% said they had been found. Still haven't been found, but 28% genuinely felt that. I mean, they genuinely believed. And these numbers are always shockingly high when you poll factual stuff that's wrong. And it's for this reason, right? Why? Well, why? Because my political power vacuum, if I'm a typical Republican maybe in 2006, is that these guys are the good guys, Republicans, Bush, whatever. These guys are the evil guys, Democrats, whatever. Right? And maintenance of my paradigm requires belief in facts that reinforce my paradigm that these guys are the good guys. They wouldn't lie to me, etc., etc., etc. Right? So this is a perfectly typical response. 28% saying they have been found. It's perfectly typical. 45% believing that Iraq had WMDs because that was consistent with their overarching political paradigm. Completely typical. Indeed, in 1968, French communists were denying the Soviet invasion of Hungary and Czechoslovakia. As it was going on, a few hundred miles to the east, and the reports were coming in, the pictures were coming in, the video was coming in, etc. Same thing, right? Now, in that spirit, I'm going to get a bit interactive now. I'm going to ask you guys a question. Some years ago, there was a headline on the Drudge Report that I quote exactly here. Iran test fires missile that can reach Israel. Okay? Anybody want to tell me, in the spirit of this talk, what is wrong with that headline? Given that, it was factually accurate. It was a correct fact, but what's the problem with it? Like, what's it actually doing, this headline? Please.
It's actually arranging the confrontation between Iran and Israel versus right. putting something in order, or putting something in uprights.
I like the first half of that, not so much the second, but okay. Yes, definitely. Yeah.
It's like somebody that reads that makes the assumption it could be a nuclear missile.
And okay,
not,
so
it's not in there.
But
it makes the causal relationship that test firing a missile means that the intent is to fire a missile at Israel.
Right. So what is it doing? What it's actually doing is, Matt Drudge is an American. His audience are Americans, right? I do not believe this is insincere. Matt Drudge believes what all Americans, most Americans believe, which is the main geopolitical fault line in the Middle East is the Jews and the Muslims, right? Israel versus the Arabs, right? That's what most Americans think. It isn't. It's the Arabs and the Persians. When this missile was created, the things that started, the things that started happening in the Middle East were more about the Arab response to the Persian missile. It was the Saudis and other countries that started to get excited. In other words, the meaning of this missile was nothing really, well, not, it was very little to do with Israel. But what Matt Drudge here is doing, and this is the take-home point, is he's looking at the world, but he's seeing his parallel. This is a statement of the American paradigm that Drudge himself and Drudge's readers operate in, that the fault line is Israel versus. And so again, Drudge's readers get reinforcement, don't they? Of their basically incorrect paradigm. See how it works? It always works this way. Now, if you don't know this, right, then most of your attempts at political persuasion are going to be ineffective. Which is, I think, logical.
Don't you think that the idiosphere, because it's not really Persian versus Arab, it's a Shia versus Sunni, and the fact that in separate statements, the Iranians had never said anything about wiping out the Saudis, although, you know.
Yeah, sure. I take your point about the Sunni Shia, but that's even more to the point, in a way, because there's no mention of Sunnis and Shias and those dynamics. It's still, whatever we say that the on-the-ground dynamics are, this is a statement of the prevailing paradigm that I would say is largely the same.
Is it a paradigm, or is it also the fact that what would resonate more with the audience?
Well, indeed, it's both of those things, because obviously if you speak to the audience's paradigm in their language, then it's going to, you know, they immediately connect it and make sense, they can accommodate it, right? So yes, I would say certainly the second, but by accident, and the issue is the first. But yeah, they're certainly not only not inconsistent, they kind of go hand in hand. So.
A question I have, does the statement itself dismiss the possibility that Iran is moving forward in a scientific front, as they proclaim? I mean, if they're true to their word, sure. They're just wanting to get their own satellites up.
I mean, look, it, what it allows, though, I mean, if you, as I said, I gave you at the beginning that this was factual, right? And it does not state factually that Iran isn't doing a million other things, right? Of course, right? But obviously the point I'm making here is reinforcement of prevailing paradigm in a misleading way. That's the point I want to drive on. Okay, now.
Well, your point, I heard on the way down here, yes, a friend of mine quoted someone said that their greatest struggle was trying to explain to Southerners that Shiite was a type of Muslim. The Shiite is a type of Muslim.
Might come back to that yet. Okay, so to move on from this slide, we've got, you know, a good amount of time here. So the thing about these paradigms is they are hardwired. Now, obviously, there's no hardwiring in the brain, but let's say they're software. They're wired, right? And they are self-supporting. And please don't forget the fact that our paradigms determine not just how we interpret the world, this is important, but the actual data that we can receive, using which we then interpret the world, right? Now, I want to actually kind of, as it were, show this directly. So these, I'm going to ask you a volley of questions. None of these is a trick question. What is that? It is a line. Well done. Give this guy a prize here. Tell me something about the orientation of this line. One horizontal line. We agree? What's this then?
Oblique line.
Oh yeah, it's projected. It's supposed to be vertical. When you give me vertical. Yeah. Okay. So what's that?
Parallel. Equal sign.
Could be parallel. And what direction are they going? All right, so you have two horizontal lines, right?
Yeah.
So, what's that?
Parallel.
Okay. How many? Okay, and what's that?
Square.
Here's the thing, right? You know what I'm doing, but you can't help but see that as a square. You can't help but see that as a square, right? And here's why. I sound like a little bit in neurology. When you look at that, there are actual cells firing in your brain. Then we can put you now in a brain scan at this resolution and determine this. You're registering line, and you're separately registering vertical, and we can pinpoint the cells that do that, more or less. Same here. You have line, horizontal, and two firing. You have cells for those concepts. When you get there, you have cells firing for two, vertical, horizontal, line, and a separate bunch for square. Right? You have learned square. It has been wired in. Now, if you stare at it long enough, you can kind of deconstruct it. You can look at it in a different way. You know, like if you look at a word and you stare at it long enough, the, you know, kind of the meaning falls out of it, and you can see the letters. But in your linguistic paradigm is square. That determines that you actually see that as a square because your brain is now wired to see that as a square. Separately from seeing it as the two pairs of parallel lines, one horizontal, one vertical, joined at the end, which that also is, which would have followed nicely from the other slides I show you, but it's not what you see.
That's just the definition of squares, two sets of parallel lines.
Right. That's my point.
So
that
you're,
is
just, you're just summarizing the two put together.
Okay, but here's
my mind.
Right, and here's what I'm doing, right? You do not look at that picture, see it as those four things orientated in that way, and then do any conscious analysis to work out that it's a square. Right? The point is that the paradigm determines the direct perception. There actually is no processing going on. You know, beyond the purely physical, neurological, immediate. There's nothing conscious going on. Alright? That's the point. That's the power of the paradigm. Right? I'm like stripping Kuhn right now. Right? Because I want you to know how bloody hard it is to sell libertarianism. Right? Why do we have to step up our game? Right? Now, this is the basis. Now obviously when I get when I do this for a day, I go, okay, so what do we do with this? And what I really get into is like the sales and marketing then of liberty ideas, right? Bearing all this in mind, using what we now know about political psychology, neurology, and the way the mind works. But of course, there's a group of people who are quite good at this anyway, and they're called salesmen, right? So we're going to be doing a little bit of kind of salesy stuff, for ideas, in a minute. I like to be a little provocative, so I'm going to quote Noam Chomsky at a libertarian convention. Some libertarians think that's not too provocative, many think it is. Here's Noam Chomsky saying what I'm saying in a relevant way, a politically relevant way, and his way. The smart way to keep people passive and obedient is to strictly limit the spectrum of acceptable opinion, but allow very lively debate within that spectrum. Even encourage more critical and dissonant views within that spectrum. That gives people the sense that there's free thinking going on, while all the time the presuppositions of the system, that's Chomsky speak for paradigm, right, are being reinforced by the limits put on the range of debate. If you're a libertarian and you watch the news, you feel this day after day, right? You know this. Okay. Now, I said we get to politics. So let's do a little bit of this paradigm stuff, and let's apply it to the prevailing political paradigm in our country. Okay, there's more to it than this, but this is a pretty good start. What is the prevailing paradigm, a political paradigm, for most folks in our country? Well, it's left versus right. It's conservative versus liberal. It's Republican versus liberal, right? Well, what does it mean for us to be, as it were, selling libertarianism into that? Right? When you are selling political ideas, it's not the establishment of the libertarian, in our case, paradigm that's difficult. It's the disestablishment of whatever the prevailing paradigm is, right? That is changing perceptions to reinforce the prevailing paradigm. And this is, as I'm saying this to you, you should all go, well, yeah, that's obvious. In a way, this whole talk is obvious. I shouldn't have to give it, but I clearly do. Because we all kind of know this stuff, but none of us use this, or very, very few of us use this stuff, right? Which is why I want to join the dots on it. So what actually is, let's talk about left and right. Now, I talked about, as it were, the contents of paradigms being kind of subconsciously used through the language that's associated with paradigm, right? So let's think about the language left and right. Left, right, they're single words, right? If I stand here, everything is left or right. There's nothing that isn't left or right. In other words, left and right, subconsciously, they cover all space. Right, so you get the Democrat, you get the Republican on CNN to discuss whatever the latest, you know, military intervention is in some country that doesn't threaten us. And you hear the left and right views, right? Maybe. That's the idea. But the point being that the unstated assumption which most of the country buys is, well, we've heard pretty much all there is we need to consider because we've got left and right. We've got our political space covered. That's loaded in the words left and right. Similarly, left and right are what else? They are opposites. We don't say left and tree. We don't say automobile and right. We say left and right. They're opposites. So the subconscious kind of paradigmatic thing going on here, the unstated assumption, if you like, is that if we hear from the liberal, self-proclaimed liberal, we hear from the self-proclaimed conservative, whatever, we've heard the two opposing views. And superficially, on that one issue that might be talked about in that moment, their views might be different. But first of all, you know, what does it mean for views to oppose each other when you're discussing something so complex and qualitative, let's say, as military intervention, first of all. But second of all, 95% of what matters, of the way our country works, of why we're even discussing what they're discussing, sits on everything they agree upon, right? So we're being sold the oppositeness, but we know, because we're here at the Libertarian Party Convention of 2016, right, that most of what ails us is everything that the duopoly has managed to do together, right? So again, the paradigm doesn't allow us to see, doesn't allow most people to see 95% of let's say, the problem. Right? What's left versus right? This is opposite. Right? So we don't go looking for that stuff. We don't go looking for the idea that, if you might say, there's a military interventionistic political culture in mainstream America. We don't see maybe the fact that the left and the right are both perfectly happy with our monetary system and how that relates to whatever they might be discussing, et cetera, et cetera. We just don't see it, we don't ask, because we're being presented these opposing views about this one thing, whereas it's the agreement, the non-opposition, that really determines why our country is like it is. Now, the last one is a little more subtle, but in some ways kind of more interesting, actually, because it's more subtle. Left and right are not really symmetrical. Now, I'm using that, again, in this kind of scientific sense. Sorry, I did physics, I already explained at the beginning. If two things, if two states are symmetrical, it just means you can map one onto the other, right? That's all it means. So basically, left and right, they're the same kind of thing, right? Like, you can map one onto the other and say, well, you know, the opposite of left is right, for example, right? Or if, you know, you flip the left by 180 degrees, you get right. It's the same kind of thing. Again, left, you know, it's not left and ultimately, right? They're completely different things, left and right, same kind of thing, right? It's, like, really obvious, but bear with me. When we, most libertarians, I think most people, believe that if people on the left are doing politics, they're doing the same thing as people on the right. I mean, they're still doing politics, they're still talking about policy, they're still talking about opinions about things that determine, that affect the direction of our country, etc., etc. I mean, left-wing politics and right-wing politics are still all kind of the same thing in here. They're trying to solve the same problems, etc., etc. No, I don't believe that's the case. You have all had this experience. You have friends on the left and you have friends on the right. And your friends on the left think that most of your friends on the right are basically callous Marxists. Right? Bad people, pretty much bad. There's something morally wrong with their politics. But your friends on the right think that your friends on the left are what? Not bad, usually just stupid. Not symmetrical. Whatever it is about my right-wing politics, if I'm a conservative, causes me to think that my left-wing friends are stupid. It's obviously different from the thing that causes my left-wing friends, to, whatever it is about my left-wing friends' politics, to think, that causes them to think that my right-wing friends are evil. So let's think about this in terms of paradox. I am going to approximate left versus right politics by saying, you think of it on these two axes, right? If you're doing left-wing politics, doing something different from right-wing politics. If I'm a liberal by default, like I was before I got, you know, before I started discovering Hayek and Bastiat and all the good stuff, I do like to say a liberal is just a libertarian who hasn't seen the data yet. Perhaps because of the paradigm, right? Oh, and by the way, an interesting little side note, which I go into in my kind of long seminar about this. Psychometrically, libertarians are like liberals, not conservatives. Psychologically, in other words, we are much more like liberals than conservatives, except with rationality turned up and empathy turned down. But otherwise, we map much more closely to liberals than conservatives, which has interesting consequences for politics too. But that's so that's for another day. But let's think about this. If I am a liberal, then as I said, you know, earlier in this, when I started to talk, I was a liberal by default. I didn't really care about politics. I'm a good guy, I want more justice rather than less, less poverty rather than more, obviously, or use government law to do that. Right? It's kind of common sense view. It's a common sense view, actually, right? So I notice or I experience the policies, my support for policies as manifesting good intentions. So for me, politics is about the manifestation of good intentions. So if someone disagrees with me, obviously, they are the opposite of manifesting good intentions. They're either not good or they're manifesting bad intentions. I'm working, as a lefty, I'm working on a more intentional axis politically, right? So that means I'm doing something completely different from somebody on the right who simply doesn't believe that you can legislate or mandate through government outcomes, right? If I just believe that the way you use the mechanism determines the outcome, rather than the thing you try and make the mechanism do determine the outcome, then I have to assess my policies in a completely different way. I know that good intentions don't get me there, so maybe I have a more, I call it here, functional view of politics. This works, this doesn't. So I have to look at what works, and well, I might look at what works, I might look at history, whatever, but I have an opinion on what works because I've analyzed something, I've read some books, whatever might be the way I get to it. And so my lefty friends, well, obviously stupid, because they haven't they read the books? Haven't they seen that this doesn't work? Haven't they seen that this works? Right? So we see here that we only ever, unless we've been to my talk, assess the other guy's paradigm from inside my own. Because that's kind of the only game in town, right? In other words, we have to work to get into the paradigm of the person we're trying to persuade. And that's kind of the important takeaway. Now, salesmen, and I guess if I have any other kind of credentials for this, my very first experience in, as an adult in America was when I was 21. And I came to Harrisburg, Pennsylvania to sell books to people. And it was the most, it was just horrendous. I was quite good at it, but I mean, I never want to do it again. I'm going to shoot my worst enemy. And I had no idea I would really be using those skills again. But actually, I did use those skills directly in writing an article that built the biggest coalition for 140 in 2012. And they also feed in to this here. So I don't just read books. Right? I don't just read books. Now, what is it that these salesmen know? They know that people's minds are changed by emotional consent and not logical argument. Right? All sales are emotional. And that is true even for libertarians and their ideas. Now, libertarians like to say, and I just kind of did say when I was standing over there, that libertarians are more rational than most of the liberals with whom they are psychologically similar. I'm generalizing, of course, but that's being tested. But the actual coming to a decision, whether it's a decision to buy a product or a commitment to a political idea, is emotional. And what I mean by that is, there's parts of the brain that handle emotion, there's part of those brain, the part of your brain, the part of your brain that handles logic. And the thing that fires when you experience the moment of conversion to a product or idea, all the fiber things in the part of the brain that sort of, that are your emotional experience. Now, this one is super, super important. What does that mean, right? It means that judgment and justification are completely different processes. If you're a political activist, if you are a candidate, put this on the wall in big writing. Judgment and justification are different processes. The way you come to that emotional commitment to a political view, to an entire worldview, or to buy a product, the judgment that this is where I stand is formed for many, many reasons, most of which you are not consciously aware of at the time. Okay? And I go into them when I do my longer talks. But your justification is always fact-based and logical, right? Especially if you're an intern. If you're highly rational, right? We all do it to some extent. We post hoc fit, we post fit our rationalization, and then we genuinely believe that our justification, our fact-based logical justification, is why we believe what we believe, and that's completely sincere and it's completely wrong. Okay? So, the reason why you need to learn about this, which means buy my book, come to my one day seminar, so, to actually engage the citizens, we need to hack the judgment process. You need to hack that mental process. You have to understand it. And indeed, salesmen say, and I was taught this when I was 21, seek first to understand before being understood. Right? It's in other words, get in the other guy's paradigm. And as we'll see long enough, you need to, as we'll see later, if you shut up for long enough, the other guy will show you his paradigm. In other words, the other guy will tell you how to sell it. Right? More salesmen wait for that. Okay. So judgment, which is how you get to a belief or purchase, is a different process from justification that you use to justify it, and that you then experience as being your reason for having gone into that place in the first place. Okay, so again, let's bring it right down to politics. I'm just going to read this line out. During the run-up to the 2004 presidential election, while undergoing fMRI policy, 30 men, half self-described as strong Republicans and half as strong Democrats, were tasked with assessing statements by both George Bush and John Kerry, in which the candidates clearly contradicted themselves. Now that is important. In all cases, these participants are going to be assessing statements that have the logical accuracy of 2 plus 2 equals 5. Right? So this is a good test environment. Right? In their assessments, Republican subjects were as critical of Kerry as Democratic subjects were of Bush, yet both let their candidate off the hook. What does let them off the hook mean? What it means is, well, the other guy is obviously an idiot because he thinks 2 and 2 equals 5, or the other guy obviously has to lie to support his view because his views are so unsupportable. Well, my guy was obviously a slip of the tongue. Well, obviously he didn't mean that, he meant this. Okay? And we do it at the level of actually kind of immediate perception. We don't have to, maybe not immediate is the wrong word, but we do it even when we're not trying to do it in our partisanship. That's an automatic process. And this is what the brain's going to show you. The part of the brain that's processing emotions fires. Why? I'm being challenged. I have an emotional reaction to that. There's a cognitive dissonance going on. There's a conflict. I have a paradigm, there's something that's not fitting, it has to be made to fit. Judgments about moral accountability, this is important. One thing I get into when I do this in depth is that, it's kind of another one of my one-liners that I think is really important. At root, all politics are the politics of identity. And I don't mean black, white, male, female. I mean, what do I believe about the people in this group? What do I believe about them as people? What do can I imagine experiencing the world as they experience it? Right? That relates to the fact that I'm going to actually assess statements by making judgments about moral accountability of the person making the statement, not the content of the statement. That's what nearly everybody does. Even when they come to a conclusion that they then justify logically using facts. Remember, judgment and justification are different processes. Okay, reward and pleasure. Now this relates to the incongruity experiment, actually. When the Democrat has worked out how it is that Bush is a bastard when he says 2 plus 2 equals 5, but Kerry is a really nice fluffy guy with the right answers, they get a massive dopamine hit. You may as well inject yourself with heroin. Our brains, like literally, it's the same. I mean, it's the same, right? So, not only, you know, remember the 1949 incongruity experiment and the sweat glands and all of that and the heart rate and all of that? Okay, well, even in our brains, our neurochemistry is wired. Our neurochemistry is such that our wiring is sticky, our paradigms are sticky. We get rewarded when we can keep them the same. So you're up against that too. Now, the bit that does reasoning, the bit that actually accesses the statement 2 plus 2 equals 5, nothing. Look at that, nothing. In 30 men, self-described strong Republicans and strong Democrats. Okay. And of course, we see this all the time, right? So back in 2006, this is a table of views of NSA surveillance programs. In 2006, when Bush was on the throne, used advisedly, 75% of Republicans were A-OK with it. Strangely, when Obama gets on the throne, those Republicans aren't unhappy with the same thing anymore. And of course, on the other side, only 37% were happy with the NSA surveillance program. 37% of Democrats were happy with Bush's, as they saw it, NSA surveillance program. But when Obama takes the throne, then everything's fine. Even though, of course, we discover things were getting worse and worse and worse, right? The majority flips from being against to being for. And so we see this in all areas of politics. So what are we going to do about it? Well, the first thing we're going to do is not trigger the reinforcement of the paradigm by making the guy who we're trying to persuade wrong. Like, you've seen this on Facebook when I go to FOIL. Right. You're wrong because, look, here's the facts, here's the argument, obviously you're wrong, right? It doesn't work. Because now, my paradigm is being threatened, my immediate thing, subconsciously, I don't have to do anything that's happened, is to defend it, right? So don't do that. And don't do the thing that's like, the really bad version of that is, well, obviously, if you believe that, You can actually kind of work this out like a little flowchart. Okay? I believe this because I'm a good person who's interested in getting things right. You believe the opposite of this. So obviously you are either not a good person or you're not interested in getting things right. Obviously you're bad or you're stupid. Right? And you see the impugning of intent or integrity or morality at the time or political arguments. And all you're going to do is make sure you might think that you win the argument, but you won't win the supporter. Right, which is why, you know, my little logo is winning supporters, not arguments. Right? We're in the business of winning supporters, not arguments. Libertarians are winning arguments all the time, and look at that. Right? So what do you choose? It's nice to win arguments. I mean, there's a time for it. In my life, the time was 3 o'clock in the morning in the hallowed halls of Cambridge University over marble cake and orange juice. Right? But now I'm trying to change the world, I'm trying to change the nation, right? So I've got to get off the ego trip and start making a decision about what matters, which is, you know, why I'm here doing this. And here's the thing. 7 billion people out there, you can find an agreement or disagreement of principle with every one of them. You get to choose where you start. Okay. Now, if you're going on a journey with someone, you have to start from where they are, because that's where they are. It would be nice to start nearer the end, because then you haven't got so far to go. Or because that's where you are. But if you want to take them with you, you've got to go to where they are, and then you've got to walk the distance, right?
Yes. For years I've been having great success with this concept I call retreating to common ground, which is basically this, is that I keep retreating a conversation to, well, what's important to you? Oh, so you believe that the government should not, you know, be in your marriage business. Excellent. Then that gives us, now I have a point of common ground, and I can start expanding the conversation from there. And if I run into trouble, I can always retreat back to the points of agreement. Well,
okay, so
you can agree on this thing.
So you can now give the rest of my talk, which is going to be a lot about doing exactly that. Where is this common ground? Right? Because that's a restatement of what I said. That's what being where somebody is. So thank you. Yeah, absolutely. Now, and by the way, you know, if this is kind of hard to get head around, it really shouldn't be. How do salesmen sell widgets? Yeah. They find the customer's need and they sell to them. No salesman goes in. I mean, I did this. I knocked on hundreds of doors in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, and I never once sold anything by saying, "Oh no, you're completely wrong about, you know, what the educational stuff you have for your kid. You got it all wrong. Let me put you right. And by the way, being part of being right is buying this book I'm trying to sell." You don't do it that way, right? You find what the need is. You find the common ground. I'm finding the common ground. So a way to kind of a disposition you can have to be effective at this is to realize that you're not actually trying to change anyone's mind at all. You're trying to kind of discover someone's mind and perhaps clarify their mind with them. Right? You're trying to do something to them. You're trying to do something with them. In other words, you're offering something. We're offering something. We're not forcing something. There's a certain kind of violence in forcing an idea on someone who doesn't want to hear it. Right? So let's extend the non-aggression principle a little bit. Right? Just because it doesn't work.
Alright? Okay. Go back for a second. Move to your previous slide. The quote, "No one has ever been persuaded by someone they don't respect." Is that yours?
Yes.
Alright, that's great.
Great. Thank you. So, always start with common ground, my top line. Seek first to understand and only then to be understood. I think I've covered a lot of this. Now, I want to give some actual political examples. Okay, so I really want to get you kind of working on this. Sanders, Trump, okay, and UKIP in England. Really interesting. Let me start with UKIP, because you've got a distance on UKIP. United Kingdom Independence Party. Party for my native land. I'm now a proud American, as of 1 month ago, but my native American. But I still keep an eye on politics across the pond, especially with respect to UKIP. Now, UKIP, United Kingdom Independence Party, is a broadly classical liberal, small L liberal, if you go to their website, small L libertarian, small D democratic party. That's how they call themselves. Here's the interesting thing. You have to really look hard on their website. They are, UKIP are not in the business of, "Let me tell you all about how the world really works. here's the reading list, creature from Jekyll Island, blah, 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 blah. Here's the worldview, sign here. Okay, that is not what they do. Now, UKIP didn't exist 20 years ago. They did not exist 20 years ago. They are half the age of the party that we are here supporting. Okay. 2 years ago, they won the British elections to the European Parliament. So they were you, and they won a national election, right? In last year, in the actual, like the general election, right, which is akin to the presidential election, they took 14 or 16% of the vote. They did it in 20 years as an insurgent, with no, i.e. obviously with no base. Like, they didn't start with a base, they had a make one. And they went from 0 to 14% in 20 years. How did they do it? They did it because they get this. If you get this, what you don't tell people is what they should think. You tell them what they already think. And you tell them the thing that they already think that isn't being told to them by anybody else, which in this case is the Democrats and the Republicans. Okay. Now, in England, what lots of people are thinking, were thinking and feeling that was not being reflected by the political establishment was the obvious unfairness in the European Union and what it was imposing on the British people. Okay. It's just unfair. Now, that's really important. This idea of just unfair. If you want to unite people, if you want to get into everybody's paradigm, regardless of where they're on the political spectrum, you have to appeal to their basic sense of human injustice. Not a sense of injustice that only makes sense because it offends a political power. It's got to offend the basic human sense that just isn't right. Okay. Now, it turns out, as has been extensively tested in behavioral economics experiments that I will go into my long talks, that people will pay, they will harm themselves to punish injustice that they perceive others meeting out on others. So A will pay to punish B for hurting C. That is human nature. It doesn't matter if you're a liberal or a conservative or a libertarian. It doesn't matter if you come from America or England or Congo. That is a very resilient result. So what you do, if you're an insurgent party like UKIP, is you speak to the immediately felt injustice that isn't being spoken to by anyone else. In other words, to England, it was speak to the problem of the EU. Laws coming down on us from people who we cannot unelect. Okay? The EU is, for my money, the biggest rising tyranny in the world right now. And I'm delighted that, by the way, the success of UKIP won the British people a referendum on staying in or leaving, which is huge. It's huge. Because also, of course, you don't actually have to win. You just have to be able to make one of the big guys lose, right? In a two-party system, if you control the guy in the middle, right, you have disproportionate power. Libertarianism has to own the swinging middle. The swinging middle has to be pro-liberty, pro-constitution, etc., etc. Now look, this has been, the UKIP has been very successful with this in England by not trying to sell the power. Yeah? As I said, we're not trying to like put one, get one, take a whole power line down, put a whole one in. It's like you already feel offended by what European bureaucrats are doing. We'll speak to that. And everybody goes, I actually tested it. I tested this 2 years ago when I went home to visit family. People from the left and people from the right who didn't have a lot of interest in politics started like, I can vote UKIP. And I was saying, why? And none of them say, because I agree with them on this policy. You hardly ever hear that, actually. It's, they're the only people talking about blah. What you choose to talk about is more important than what you say about it. Write that down if you're a candidate. What you choose to talk about is more important than what you say about it. In most cases. And so we come to Trump and Sanders. Right? On the right, Trump is talking to if we go back to like the thing that put Trump on the map, the immigration comments, right? He's talking to a felt injustice. It simply cannot be right. And you don't need a political paradigm to make sense of what I'm about to say. Now, you might disagree with what I'm about to say, but 90% of Americans don't disagree with what I'm about to say. It's a human thing, not political. It just can't be right that people can break laws and A, just get away with it, and B, get advantages that people who don't break laws don't get. Right? That is a basic human sentiment that comes out in those behavioral economics experiments. Right? On the left, Bernie Sanders, right, is the guy saying, it just can't be right that these people that, you know, make, I don't know, that may be 10 times clever or spend or put in 10 times more effort, make a million times more money, and look at what's happening to all you guys. It just, there's obviously something wrong on its face, right? The feeling of something wrong on its face precedes any political ideology. And so they're getting this insurgent support, and they're doing quite well on it, right? When I was giving a speech to the Libertarian Party in Washington State 3 years ago, it might have been four, I was trying to explain it. And I said, so what's the sense of felt injustice that we as libertarians can speak to immediately? Right? And I felt at that time there were two things. Crony corporatism, right, which Sanders has got, shame on you all, right? And because that's our issue. Right? And so I'm distracted by the other side of that wall. Civil rights, the whole Snowden and the takedown of civil rights. Now, for my money, like the scariest one is the civil rights thing, but the American media are completely derelict, as we know, and there's lots to understand about the civil rights thing. So the one that's immediately felt, more immediately felt, is the Koerner corporatism thing. And I said, that's going to be the basis of an effective political insurgency. Get onto it. While Sanders obviously was watching me on YouTube, the Libertarian Party guys obviously forgot, because look where we are, right? But it's in, so you're seeing it play out. And if you understand that, don't be surprised by the fact that those people who were supporting Trump were actually supporting very, very different policies when, let's say, those same people were supporting Bush in 2000, was it four, when Bush ran the first time. Remember, Bush ran on a no-nation building, small government, like a whole, he ran very different, right? A non-interventionist thing from how Trump is running. Right? But it's the same people. They just, it's not about the politics. It's not about the politics. Right? It's like, now that sense of felt injustice is so strong that they're being pulled away. Sanders on the left, Trump on the right, so on and so forth. Now, I'm going to talk a little bit about, it relates to this common ground thing. I mentioned all politics are politics of identity. In other words, can I imagine what it feels like to be you? What actually do we have in common? Now, when we're looking for the political common ground, that's great. Look for the political common ground, use it if you find it. But be aware that you don't need political common ground to have common ground. There is such a thing as cultural common ground. There's such a thing as common ground by virtue of our shared humanity. We all have the same psychodynamics, right? We all feel anger, we all feel fear, we all feel love, and we pretty much all feel them for exactly the same reason, right? If you threaten my child, I'm gonna get angry, right? I have a husband or wife, I love them, and I behave accordingly, right? It doesn't matter where you come from, what side of the political spectrum, which part of the world. So it's also important to understand that when we're doing politics, we're doing culture as well, and this takes us back to Trump, right? There's a cultural and a personal affinity between Trump and the people supporting him, right? He's a bit of an authoritarian by personality, and so are most of his supporters, right? Now, let me go back to UKIP. UKIP, being a classical liberal, libertarian-y kind of anti-EU party, when they were running at the general election last year, all of the pundits said they will take votes from the Conservatives, right? Just as you always hear here, oh no, libertarians will take votes from the Republicans. It was the same kind of thing, right? Because the policies are similar, right? Or more similar. I mean, through prevailing paradigms, people see libertarian policies as more similar to Republican ones than to Democratic ones. Whether that's true or not is another discussion. But that's kind of like, that's the broadly held opinion for those who care about this. Same thing was going on in UKIP, with UKIP in England. So all the pundits said, oh, this is really bad for the Conservatives. Labour, our Democrats, right, are going to come up, as it were, kind of, they're going to benefit from the splintering on the right, and we're going to have a Labour government. Okay.
Yes.
Nobody predicted that we would have a Conservative government. Nobody predicted we were going to have a Conservative government in England after the election, but that's what we got. Here's what happened. UKIP did take votes from the Conservatives in the South, where the Conservatives were strong. But up in the North, where everybody votes Labour, they took votes from the Labour Party. Now, there's like nothing in common politically between UKIP and Labour policies. But there's everything in common culturally between UKIP and the kind of people in UKIP. And Nigel Farage, you know who Nigel Farage is, right? I think he's the most famous English politician in America. He's the guy who gives those, okay, that's interesting. Usually when I'm in libertarian audiences, everybody nods. Nigel Farage is the guy who stood up in the European Parliament and told the president exactly what a piece of scum he is and where he should go, and became a multi-million view YouTuber, right? And goes around, and he's like a safer Donald Trump. He goes around telling it like it is. And everybody else is just telling him like he's fresh or whatever, right? But his policies aren't like, he's not as dangerous. Like, I mean, I like Nigel Farage. But he's that kind of guy. But here's the thing. He's always filled with a beer and a cigarette. They smoke a lot of beer. They smoke a lot of cigarettes and drink a lot of beer afterwards. Right? He's always doing his little TV spots in a pub. Those Labour voters up north get that guy. They're not interested in his politics. Okay? Don't think political allegiance follows political views. It's the other way around. I'll do whatever political views, right, kind of fit with the guy that I liked now. And I'm going to like you because I have a cultural affinity or a personal affinity, and now you can easily explain why all these supporters who were supporting Bush on a completely different platform when Bush ran the first time, and now having to support a completely opposite platform actually with Trump. Cultural affinity, cultural identity, personal affinity, personal identity, right? It always works. It always works. Let's go to the next slide. Because it illustrates this. I've kind of said this, but I just wanted to give you a visual. Right? What we're trying to do is overcome these political differences. We're trying to move people's political power, right? I'm trying to close the gap like this. So where do we go for the common ground? Well, the closest common ground to political differences is shared politics, right? Which I think we're kind of touching on here. Sometimes you can't even find that. Sometimes the common ground is a shared reaction to something in the culture. Let me give you an example. I wrote an article that also got a lot of attention a couple of years ago called Your Problem with Guns or Gays is Not Political. Not political. Right? Now, there have been a couple of ongoing big political issues. Second Amendment stuff, guns, and gay marriage, and we had all of that stuff last year. Now that I'm in Liberty Circles and I live up in the Pacific Northwest, I get invited to go shoot guns by good Liberty friends. And I'm British, which means I don't have a lot of experience there, right? So I went a couple of years ago to the range with a friend of mine, Rob, and I got kind of given this all kind of guns. It was a lot of fun, learned lots, really great. And I called my mother that week and said, oh, Mum, I've been doing this, that, and the other. I went up to the range and I shot some guns. And she, there's this kind of pause on the other end of the phone, and she says, my God, Robin, that's the last thing I ever imagined you would enjoy. And I thought about it for a second, and I was like, yeah, but Mum, that's because you've never met anybody, a normal human being, that shoots guns, right? Like, you have no conception, being British, of how a decent person can get any pleasure out of firing off something that actually is made to kill people. And she was like, yeah, that's pretty much it. And it is pretty much it. see, firing guns to a Brit is a cultural anathema. We actually have no way of imagining why anybody would want to do that. If you want to do that, it's pre-political. There's no ideology here. It's like, I can't imagine what it must be like to be you. I can't quite trust you. There's a cultural gap here, right? That's how it is with people on the left against Second Amendment. Right? Now, we post hoc rationalize, so let's post hoc rationalize, let's say, the anti-Second Amendment views. You get the rationalization on the left, you'll get the political justification, but it's much more visceral. Right? I'm now talking about the difference between the judgment and the justification. Where does the judgment come from? It's essentially a cultural one, right? And it's not cognitive. It's much more visceral. It actually is a kind of weak disgust. And think about that. I'm just trying to put a name on the feeling out of which you then build politics. Let's look on the other side, excuse me. I'll talk about the religious right and the gay marriage issue. Okay? If I were brought up in the religious right household with that kind of paradigm, not only do I not want to do whatever it is you guys do, you gays, I can't imagine even wanting to do that. It is disgusting, right? To me, if that's how... It's visceral, but then I have to post hoc justify it, right? But that's not how I got to my judgment. How do you close that gap? Well, let me tell you how I close the gap. I have a bit of a conservative streak. I mean, I think, you know, we're liberty people, but we're probably more, we have issues where we might be more conservative than most libertarians are, or more liberal than most libertarians are. That's all cool. And I think I've got a bit of a conservative streak when it comes to bringing up children. I've just got this idea that if you're going to cause something to exist, you've got an almighty responsibility, like an infinite responsibility, which is why it terrifies me when I don't have any kids. I've seen a therapist about this, but I'm happy. And I'm aware that she has it. I mean, obviously, it's a completely different generation, right? About 17 years old. And she just has this uneasiness about, as a society, you know, it does look like there's a certain best thing to give children, that, you know, situation to have been born into, with a mother and a father, and she just has this uneasiness. I mean, she's not, you know, she's not crazy religious right or anything like that. But I get it, because she genuinely does care for children, and she knows her experience as a mother, and she just can't imagine how a child might have everything a child would want without a father and a mother. She certainly thinks there's a burden of proof on those who bring a child into the world without that. Okay. Now, I completely get that because she's my mother. I was brought up with her, by her. But I made two friends in New York. I lived in New York for 4.5 years. And they're two gay guys. And they adopted a little girl. They're two gay white guys. They adopted a little black girl. And this girl, and I put this in this article that I made, by the way. Your problem with guns and gays is not political. I told the story there. This little black girl is now having a life a million times better than she would have had today. Now, I would have to imagine, if I'm going to take an anti-gay adoption position, I have to look my friends in the eye and say, whatever my theories, whatever my politics in the abstract, you should not be allowed to do that for that little girl, and I would use the force of law and government to stop you. It's not political anymore, right? It's not political anymore. Similarly, when I go to the range with my friend Rob, right? Who, by the way, is an open carry guy in Washington State, and therefore actively defending that, right? I'd have to say, you shouldn't be able to have that kind of defend your family and to take on a tyrannical government should it ever come to that. And I would use the force of law to stop you, and by the way, give all the guns to the guys who, you know, the most dangerous, saying you can't have it, right? But it becomes personal, because now I'm talking about him and his family. And I know these as good people. I know them as good people. I have a way into them, and their way of life is good people. So this is going to sound like really kind of kitsch. But one of the best way to close this gap and be able to get into someone's paradigm is to go meet people who live out of that paradigm and make a relationship. You don't need many. You don't need many. But it's the best way to understand someone before insisting on being understood. And I say that here because If we don't have shared politics, we may have shared cultural experiences. You may just be a dad. And your shared cultural experience, or your shared experience, is you know, the being a father, right? And all the things that come with that. If you're a libertarian and you're trying to persuade, a Bernie-supporting dad, right? Start with being a dad, right? And if in 20 minutes you can't get to the creature from Jekyll Island, don't try, okay? Like, seriously, if as a libertarian, you let the other guy know that you want to understand, because you genuinely do, this isn't manipulation, this is the only way you're going to succeed, you have to do it this way. You have to understand before I insist on being understood. You will go away knowing better how to persuade the next Bernie supporter, and this guy will be more primed to respond positively to the next libertarian he meets. So funny that we bang on about the non-aggression principle. And the experience that many people have for libertarians is how bloody verbally aggressive they are. Okay. There's a cultural gap that belies our politics. And as I said, if you really have no shared culture that you can find, you can always go to shared humanity. Those psychodynamics, what makes us frightened, what makes us angry, what makes us sad, etc., etc.
If I could.
Yeah.
The LGBT community has been using that for years and have great success with getting people to come along to their viewpoints by engaging creature people in conversations. And it turns out that once a mother realizes their own child is gay and see that person is good, then all of a sudden that mother is greatly okay with other people that happen to be gay because they've now had a personalized experience.
That's exactly right. And actually, thank you for that. In California, after there was an initiative that got passed, I can't remember what it was exactly, but it was something to do with abortion rights. And there was massive success in that the pro-choice people had in response, sending out young women who had abortions to actually just go and talk about their experiences to mothers on the doorstep. And there was a massive change in the areas where they went out. And interestingly, the change stuck. Right, because there were human connections there. I mean, basically, what they actually did was, okay, we're going to form masses of relationships, was basically the idea that was tried in a small way. I mean, obviously, you don't actually form an ongoing relationship with people who knock on their door and talk to them. But the approach was to actually have a human connection between women and many, many votes of swaying, and the swaying of the position stuck. And that's always the hardest thing in a lot of these political campaigns. Is getting the change to stick. And it's all about that. Now, there's a few tactics that you can use in doing this. I mean, I've given you some broad sweeps, some principles to apply, but there are tactics that salesmen use. And you can use them one-to-one, you can use them in speeches, you can even put them into written articles. One is to use the vocabulary and the style of the people you're talking to. I write for the Huffington Post. I am not a progressive. But I am happy to use words like welfare. I will even use words like social justice and economic justice. Why? Because the free market is the best source of economic justice we have. But I'll use economic justice to signal to you that I'm happy to read the books that you read, use the language you use, and get on your ground to have the discussion. Right? Another one, meet the objection up front. This works like a drill. When I was selling books door to door in Harrisburg, Pennsylvania, each of my books was $65. I was trying to sell a book for $65. And I was trying to sell five of these books, right? That's $300 for five books that sit on your table like that. Okay, it's a lot of money. So it doesn't matter how good the sale is, you know one of the objections is going to be, that's the price, right? This works like magic. Meet the objection up front. If you know that the objection is going to be something, then be the first person in the discussion to say it. Just by getting there first, you utterly diffuse it. So for example, before I got to telling the price of my books, I would compare what I was selling to other things that did similar things and were a lot more expensive, like a set of Encyclopedias Britannica, for example, because it was still on the internet. But it worked, because what you're doing is you're kind of reframing, right? You're signaling, you're it's almost like you are kind of getting into the paradigm in a subtle way, right? You're saying, where you are, I'm already there. I've already thought of that, right? Specifically, when I wrote the article in support of Ron Paul on the Huffington Post, the argument was, the reason you voted against Bush and for Obama the first time was XYZ, good liberal principles. Bush did ABC, now you've seen Obama has done ABC, so now you've got a switch. You can't support Obama now if you're good liberals, so I'm affirming their good intentions, or is their positive intention, right? Stick to your principles, and now vote for the person in the race that's going to give you what you voted for, or what you thought you voted for when you voted for Obama, who happens to be an old white conservative Republican called Ron Paul, right? Has a track record against premierism, against unnecessary military intervention, for civil rights. Okay, that's the case I made. But I knew, with the Huffington Post doing this, I'm not going to get past, but the welfare state. He wants to take down the welfare state. He's one of those callous capitalists, right? So the very next paragraph was, now I know, if you're, you know, one of my liberal friends reading this, like, on the Huffington Post, that like me, you're concerned about the most economically disadvantaged people in our community, and there's the issue that you're concerned about the welfare state, blah, blah, blah. And go check out the article and you'll see how I did. So let me just ask you, are you so sure that our current one-size-fits-all federal delivery of welfare that takes no account of the people, of the circumstances, of the people it is trying to serve, is the very best way to deliver that welfare? Or should we at least be having a discussion about that too? So I got there first, I refused it, didn't tell them they were wrong, I told them they were right, I affirmed the principle, and then by affirming their principle, in other words, I'm inviting them to, as it were, test a specific thing that they support against principles that they are committed to. Not principles that I'm committed to. I'm not trying to make their principles wrong and place them in line. And it worked like a dream and it went viral, as I said. So that was an example of meeting the objection up front in an article. Subvert the expectation. If the person knows you're one of those freaky, callous libertarians, then just don't say anything that freaky, callous libertarians say, right? You know, don't get to, you know, the monetary system in the second sentence, right? Don't freak out when they say economic justice, right? Or Bernie Sanders, right? And I'm going to give you a little example of that in a minute to kind of close out this talk. Another thing is ask questions, don't give the answers, right? Our brains handle differently things that we believe are ours, including our views, from those we believe are other people's. I'm going to go into more detail on this when I get to do long talks. So you're going to ask questions to lead people to the answers that you want them to discover. Whatever the thing is you're trying to tell them, formulate it as the question where that is the answer. Okay? And then when you've made the sale, stop. Just stop. Many sales are lost because the salesman doesn't shut up. Now, I have a radio show, and I interviewed Grover Norquist a while ago. And interestingly, like, Norquist and I, on like kind of the epistemology on the sales and marketing video ideas, we see a lot of this the same way. But he really made a strong statement about this point. He said this. He said, there is already a libertarian majority at the ballot box in America. And I was like, you just mean like most people are libertarians. He said, no, no, no. At the ballot box we have a majority. I was like, what are you talking about? He said, nobody has more than one or two vote moving issues. Usually it's one. And usually on that one vote moving issue, they want to be left alone. There's 50% of Americans he reckons that's true for. He said, so what we need to do is piece together the coalition of leave me alone on my one issue, please. Homeschoolers, religion, gay marriage, gun rights. He's like, but all of these people are only interested in that one issue, maybe one more. So when you've got the guy on gay rights, don't tell him, oh great, you've really got it. Now let me tell you why you need to support the Second Amendment too. Because you're just about to lose the coalition and you start to piece together. But that's how electoral politics works. Right? I know it would be nice if everybody has the road to Damascus experience that most libertarians have at some point, right? I kind of come more from the left, many come from the right, and when I do this, I love hearing stories from like even my audiences that they tell me, you know, oh, my God, Ron Paul woke me up, or whatever the book was, you know, it was Basquiat that did it, or whatever. But, you know, no, we need to put this country back on rails, yeah? So let's piece together that those coalitions. Let's let people experience our helping them on the issue where they want to be left alone. And then wait to be asked. Wait to be asked about whatever is your particular favorite libertarian issue, right? It was actually the monetary system and the Jekyll Island stuff and all that that kind of really got me into it. I hardly ever talk about it. Because if I'm thinking about myself and it's not a concern of the person I'm speaking with, then they're bored. They're bored. Most arguments you make as libertarians simply will work because they're wanted at the time. And they simply will fail because they're not wanted at the time by the person who is using it. Okay. Someone who's really good at this is Pendulet. And you all know Pendulet, you know he's a libertarian, right? I particularly like, I'll just give you one example, he's got this little line, could we solve this problem by increasing freedom rather than reducing it? And I'm using this as a bit of a case study. Because it's great. You can almost like go away and try and formulate your views in questions like this. It's a question versus a statement, so it's essentially collaborative rather than combative, right? We are going to go on this journey together, from where we are to where we want to go. Great. There's nothing to resist here. Right, there's nothing to resist. I mean, that's extraordinary. Think about that, right? You can actually do this on anybody, left and right. You're having a libertarian, you're moving in a libertarian direction. And there's nothing for them to argue about. I mean, there actually is nothing for them to argue about. It's kind of magical. But it completely falls out of the kind of things I'm talking about. So it puts you on the same side with whoever you're speaking with. It's also humble. Oh my God, it tends, we need to be humble. Humble, humble, humble. Humility invites humility. Honesty invites honesty. It really works. Just go try it out. And I say it's humble, I mean, just to be clear. He doesn't claim to have all the answers, which also is always a really good thing if you're making a political argument. Because one of the difficulties that libertarians get in, and I think this is going to come up when I do my debate with Adam sitting at the back, thanks for being here, about anarchism and minarchism on Sunday. One of the problems we have is we have a worldview, we have a place we want to get to, and then we try and argue for this destination, this political destination. Now, write this down too if you're a candidate or an activist. Our job in persuading is to get people to move the standard of persuasion from must I believe this down to can I believe this? Right? In other words, you've got to get on the same side, got to do all this politics of identity stuff to get people to want to believe what you're telling them. In other words, political persuasion isn't so much like winning a debate as winning a second date. Right? That's really what it is psychologically. Yeah. So with that in mind, we don't need to persuade someone of this wonderful libertarian, minarchist, anarchist utopia with sound rights. We don't need that. Right? All we need today is an agreement to go in this direction, one step towards liberty. That's all that matters, right? Is that we're going in the same direction. It's much easier to get somebody to agree with you on the direction towards liberty, that it would be better to solve any problem by increasing freedom rather than reducing it, than to agree with me on all the specifics of where I want to end up. Because if the person I'm speaking to isn't already well disposed, and he finds one thing wrong with my worldview, that's all he's going to think about, talk about, and ask about. You lost it. Okay? So direction, not destination. Magical sentence. Really good stuff. Another way of putting that is it simply doesn't specify a single position. Why specify? Actually, there are as many single positions, libertarian positions, as there are libertarians anyway. So why are we fighting for our own when we all need to take our countries the same direction? And I'm kind of saying the same thing in different ways, but I'm doing this because I really wanted to stick. If you make no claim to being right, then it's really hard to argue with you. But Pendulet isn't really making claim to about being right, right? Also, there's no ideology required to accept the premise of the question. That's really important too, right? You don't have to already believe something to play this game with me, to answer this question with me. Everybody, yeah, we have different ideas of freedom. Like for the guy who goes to the range every week with his son, his gun is a big part of his idea of his freedom. To the people that have just won their right to marry their gay partner, that's what freedom tastes like. Okay? But they can both answer this question and use the word freedom. It's okay to use the words that mean different things to different people. Indeed, use that. Use that to advantage as libertarians. You know, there's this sad thing that the word liberal has been co-opted by the progressives, right? But that's fantastic if you're a writer on the Huffington Post. Because it gives me all this room to play with. I can speak to liberals, use the word liberal, and I'm not being, I can speak to them. I can be talking about me and them at the same time in one word, even though we have completely different. But it's a bridge for me, right? So think about that too. Now, I already said identities are found more in shared concerns than in shared opinions. Again, this bears some reiteration. I don't speak Spanish, so I don't know how to say Jose Ortega y Gasset, but that's the name of the Spanish philosopher who said, tell me to what you pay attention, I will tell you who you are. So true. You don't need to know the views of someone to know his politics. If you know he is at a gun exhibition, just knowing he's there, right? That's what he cares about. Somebody turns up to you, you just know that somebody goes to a gay pride march, right? You don't need to know, you don't have to have a conversation with him about what he believes about gay rights and nature. You know an awful lot about him because you know what he cares about, right? It's what do you pay attention to that you need to know to find out how you identify with people. So, I'm going to leave you with an actual something you can use. And to frame it, I want you to think about this. I believe, that true capitalism in a free market is just about the best thing engine for reduction of poverty the world has ever seen. And so I would be quite, I would be being honest and accurate and authentic in saying, I'm a capitalist, and here's why, and one of the great outcomes of capitalism is it reduces poverty at this massive rate. You know, historical examples, look what's going on in China, etc., etc. But am I actually talking in that, if I do that, am I talking about poverty or am I talking about capitalism? I'm talking about capitalism. I'm making a case that relates to poverty, but I'm talking about capitalism. My signal concern is capitalism. Right? If I'm talking to a lefty, that isn't going to work. I've got to change it around. Right? I mean, I'm being a little crude here, but I'm speaking with respect to politics of the left being politics of good intention. Right? Concerns with victim groups. This is also super important, by the way. I do a whole section in my day-long talk about how left-wing politics is driven by the identification of victim groups. Okay? You can't understand that of left-wing politics deeply unless you understand how victim groups drive left-wing thinking. But obviously the poor is a victim group for the left, right? That's all we need to know from that, clearly, right? Okay, so let's say I believe that, which I do. How would I reframe it? Sometimes it's just a question of reordering content. This is something that free market conservatives, libertarians might say all the time. I'm a capitalist because I'm for freedom, and capitalism is the best way of reducing poverty. Okay? Has a completely different effect from, I am for reducing poverty, and so support the freedom of people to trade for mutual benefit, and that to me is what capitalism means. See? One speaks to the right, one speaks to the left. Same content. But I'm starting on the common ground. I mean, in a very obvious, superficial way, I'm starting on the common ground. The concern is poverty, that's where I start. If I'm talking to someone on the left, these are examples, speaking to progressives. So, compare and contrast. I'm against the welfare state because it does work, it destroys compassion and increases poverty. That's the case I've made in my article. How might we redo that to speak to the left? Remember, this is coming from the Huffington Post writer. Okay. I'm concerned about the loss of compassion for the poorest of society. I'm concerned how one-size-fits-all programs don't take into account the circumstances of suffering Americans. They don't provide opportunities, but they disincentivize the very actions that would help people the most. That's why we need a welfare system, I put that in to be provocative. With better targeting and incentives, I will drive decision-making down toward those whose lives welfare affects. So let's do a little bit of parsing on that, right? Concerned about the loss of compassion for poor in society. Signals concern, it says I'm concerned. Compassion, I'm speaking their language. Specifically, I'm touching on the moral dimension of care. I talk about moral dimensions when I do like, the comprehensive talk. Conservatives, libertarians, and liberals, we live in basically different moral universes. And the driving moral dimension for liberals, for progressives, is the care-harm dimension. And they focus an awful lot on the care end of that dimension. So you want to frame all of your sentences as caring statements. I mean, it's obvious when I say it, right? You know, but you haven't been doing it, because otherwise you'd be getting more conservative. Okay, let's carry on. I'm concerned how one-size-fits-all programs don't take into account the circumstances of suffering Americans. Suffering Americans! I'm using their language, suffering Americans. That's who we care about, right? That's our progressives. I'm using their vocabulary. And again, I'm saying I am concerned, statement of care. And I think it's a non-ideological statement. It's not a statement about a philosophy. Okay. Therefore, it doesn't come up against the paradigmatic wall. Okay, suffering Americans, yeah. So, they don't provide opportunities, but disincentivize the very actions that would help people the most. I'm concerned with helping people the most. I'm still caring. That's why we need a welfare system with better targeting and incentives. Now, I said I put this in to be provocative. Oh, and that's a shame. You can't read that, right? My little note down there says that I'm using comfortable vocabulary for my audience. Welfare system. I mean, right there, I'm subverting the expectation. I mean, that's so much ground if you're talking to a progressive, right? Now, for me, the welfare system, free market's a welfare system. I mean, there's no better, but he's never going to want to have that conversation with me, right? Because I'm not basically taking a position that I can't even talk to you and use your language because you're such an idiot. I'm not doing that, right? It's no good saying, you want to be on common ground if you don't actually do it. So get comfortable with words like economic justice, because it makes reflective. Here's the point. You're not committing to a meaning when you say welfare system. Just because in our cultural and political paradigm, the word welfare system does mean something to most people, doesn't mean you have to buy that meaning, all right? And again, it's a pro-caring statement. And I would drive decision-making down toward those whose lives welfare affects. Now again, I'm talking about a direction here. And I don't just mean, what I mean is I'm not stating or describing some non-welfare utopia, which is all runs perfectly in some capitalist free market or whatever, which is going to cause the guy I'm talking to bring his progressive mental powers to find one error in my worldview, right? Well, who wouldn't want to drive decision-making down toward those whose lives welfare affects? Remember, see here, what I'm doing all the time is I'm talking about the people, not the ideas. The people, not the ideas. The only ends of politics, the only legitimate ends of all politics are people. We're only here because of people. And it's weird because since I went to Liberty Movement, one of the most fantastic things is just the sheer amount of love that the people have that I am dealing with. Like, there is such genuine care. But we get on our high horses about ideas, because we really do like our ideas, because there's a beauty, right, about getting this stuff right. There is an intellectual beauty, right? But don't forget that, don't consider this crap, right? The left talk about people all the time, and they're right to talk about people. If we're talking about ideas more than we talk about people, then they are absolutely right to be suspicious of us for caring more about ideas than people. But the only reason we're doing the ideas is because, at the end of the day, the welfare, in the proper sense of that term, of people, right? So don't be afraid. Use the word. Talk about people all the time. Ideas second.
If I could add to that, I can easily see how that when somebody is reading this, even if they disagree with you later on what your specific policy suggestion is, they're not going to think that you're a bad guy.
Right.
Oh, no, I get it. We're just trying to get to the same place. There's a sense of that we're in this together by reading this example.
Exactly. And this is what I mean by politics of identity. Because as soon as you're the bad guy or representative of a bad or dangerous group, our identities, are split. We lose on that, right? But all the while we have at least that, for example. He might come back and have the conversation again. I mean, the door's open, right? The heart is open. So again, you see only what you know. See, Goethe, it's his one line. It's the whole presentation in one line. And if you want the whole presentation plus a lot more in one book, out in July. And I don't just go into the psychology of this stuff. I go into, if you like, the cultural dynamics with historical examples. And this is an essentially optimistic book. It is going to be okay because we have been here before. And we have 1,001-year history. When I say we, I'm talking about the Anglo tradition. The first constitutional document to limit government was written in 1014. It was the Anglo-Saxon Charter. And 1776 and all that, and by the way, 1776 is the retail price of the book. was a high point in the Anglo tradition that has given us the liberties that we are fighting to keep. I couldn't do what I do in England. That's how bad it's got. If we lose it here, it's lost. I teach this stuff in Poland, I've been to Kyrgyzstan, Brazil, Slovakia, Slovenia. I go, I'm teaching liberty, I teach political communication. They still look to the shining city on the hill. So please learn this stuff and let's keep the lights on. Thank you very much.